Our planet has been getting warmer. But how well do scientists understand why? Welcome to America Uncovered. I'm Chris Chappell. Our planet. Beautiful. Diverse. Complex. So how well do scientists understand our planet? In particular, how well do they understand global warming? But before I'm able to examine that issue, YouTube is probably trying to preempt it by putting a link to the Wikipedia entry on global warming right below this video. If you click the link, Wikipedia will tell you, matter-of-factly, that global warming is a long-term rise in the average temperature of the Earth's climate system, and that the term commonly refers to the mainly human-caused observed warming. So YouTube and Wikipedia have teamed up to editorialize my video before I've even started. The article on global warming is one of many thousand semi-protected articles. You can tell by the lock icon. That means you have to be a confirmed user to edit the page. And it's usually a sign that the topic is controversial. You can find the same lock icon for other topics I've covered on America Uncovered, like gun control and ISIS. Even the other ISIS. I mean, Egyptian mythology was controversial at the time. Back when Amun and Ra were combined into Amun-Ra, those were some real flame wars. I hope that the five people who got that joke appreciate it. Anyway, here's the crazy part. I'm not a conspiracy theorist. I'm a journalist and a comedian whose jokes aren't even that funny. What I'm going to talk about in this episode shouldn't even be controversial. I asked viewers what they wanted to know about climate change, and they wanted me to look into how well scientists understand global warming. I'm not here to take a position. I'm just here to explore how much scientists understand it and how much consensus there is. So, let's go back to that Wikipedia page. The first issue is the Earth getting warmer? Is there a long-term rise in average temperature? The scientific understanding of this is pretty straightforward. Reasonably good surface measurements of temperature started being collected in about 1880. Since then, the average surface temperature of the planet has risen by about 1 degree Celsius or 1.8 degrees Fahrenheit. There are a lot of ways to measure surface temperature now, from weather stations to buoys to satellites, so it's gotten more and more accurate over time. And there does seem to be broad scientific consensus on this point. The average surface temperature of Earth has gotten a little warmer between 1880 and today. Does that mean we know what's going to happen in the next 100 years? Maybe, but also maybe not. That depends on how good our climate change models are, and we'll get to that. But first, let's address Wikipedia point number two, the mainly human-caused part. You may have heard this before. 97% of scientists agree global warming is happening and humans are the cause. As the Consensus Project puts it, the debate is over. Wait, the debate is over? Okay, I guess that's it for this episode of America What's that, Shelley? Click learn more? But they just said the debate is over. Fine, I'll learn more. Ah, I see. 97% of published climate papers with a position on human-caused global warming agree global warming is happening and we are the cause. Wait. With a position on human-caused global warming? Are there scientists who don't have a position on whether humans are causing global warming? Turns out, yes. But those scientists are often ignored. This 97% only accounts for the scientists who take a position. And even NASA pushes that figure. But that's super misleading. Here's why. The NASA page says 97% or more of actively publishing climate scientists agree, asterisk, climate warming trends over the past century are extremely likely due to human activities. And that asterisk points us to a study which cites another study, the most widely cited consensus study by John Cook et al., which is this one. This is the source of the claim that 97% of scientists support anthropogenic global warming, or AGW. Anthropogenic global warming means caused by human activity. So, here's how they conducted the study. They looked at the abstract of about 12,000 peer-reviewed scientific papers that matched the terms global climate change or global warming. They didn't do any climate science and they didn't read the papers. They only read the abstracts, that is, the summaries of each paper. And they found that about two-thirds of the papers expressed no position on whether humans were causing global warming. Only a third said humans were the cause. The final 1% was divided between scientists who said humans were not causing global warming or just weren't sure. So how do you get 97% of scientists agree humans are causing global warming? Well, what better way to reach consensus than to take out the parts that don't fit? That's better. Now 97% of scientific papers agree. That's literally where the commonly cited 97% agreement comes from. It's like if I say 97% of my viewers like America Uncovered, but only among the viewers who've emailed me specifically about whether they like or dislike America Uncovered. Frankly, why is it not 100%? Who would even bother to send me an email to tell me they don't like me? To be clear, I do not want to find out. Anyway, 97% of people agree. Chris Chappell is amazing and the debate is over. See? My jokes really aren't that funny. But anyway, among the scientists who have taken no position, that study didn't break down why they took no position. For example, they might have been looking at different aspects of global warming, but not at what causes it. Anyway, the simple 97% consensus figure now gets repeated by media and institutions. And it's often used without explaining that it only includes the much smaller number of papers where the scientist took a position. John Cook, the lead author of the 97% study, said that the motivation for the analysis was the importance of scientific consensus in shaping public opinion and therefore policy. So, the point was to promote consensus and then use that to shape public policy. Got it. Because there's a big difference between not everyone agrees about the science, but we should still have a discussion in good faith about potential policy, versus if you don't adopt my policy, we will all die. Not that anyone would do that. Now, Cook isn't the only person who has claimed there's broad consensus about man-made global warming. But all the studies on this generally have the same flaw. They include the small number of scientists who say it's not man-made, but ignore the large number of scientists who don't take any position on it. Now, to be clear, I'm not saying I think humans are not causing global warming. I'm saying I'm not taking a position, like those two-thirds of abstracts that were taken out of the equation. But I am taking a position on the fact that the results of this study are often used in a misleading way. 97% of people agree on that. So how well do scientists understand global warming? Well, it turns out that climate science is unbelievably complicated. I'll give some examples. About 13,000 years ago, there was a period called the Younger Dryas period. Measurements taken from Greenland ice core samples showed that the temperature dropped significantly. According to this paper from Columbia University, at the end of the Younger Dryas, average annual temperatures increased by as much as 10 degrees Celsius in 10 years. That's more than 100 times faster than the 1 degree change we've experienced over the last 140 years. How did that happen? Well, it's a touchy subject that is currently the focus of much research, but don't worry because this scenario may be irrelevant for future climate change. The point is, climate scientists don't really understand what caused it, even though it was a sudden and huge global warming event that was definitely not caused by human industry. Unless The Flintstones was an animated documentary.
That's a heavy rock.
Scientists also don't understand much about, for example, sea level changes. In the period since 1880, while temperatures increased by 1.8 degrees Fahrenheit, global sea levels have risen by about 9 inches. That's a lot. And if the oceans continue to rise, it will be a major problem for coastal areas. Huge parts of the Netherlands are already threatened by rising ocean levels, and so are a lot of island nations like Japan, the Philippines, and Kiribati, wherever that is. In fact, if sea levels keep rising, even big parts of Lower Manhattan could be underwater. I mean, not Wall Street. Won't somebody please think of the poor people on Wall Street? But while 9 inches, and especially a few feet, may seem really scary, keep this in mind. Over the course of the last 500 million years, world sea levels have gone up and down dramatically, sometimes as much as 700 feet higher than today, at other times 100 feet lower. All of that without human activity. And while scientists do understand that continental ice shelves play a major role in changing sea levels, they don't understand all the mechanisms that cause these ice shelves to form and melt. But what about carbon dioxide, or CO2? We've released a huge amount of CO2 into the atmosphere since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution. And CO2 is a greenhouse gas, meaning it traps heat from the sun, making temperatures rise. That's true. In a famous scene in An Inconvenient Truth, Al Gore dramatically stands on a cherry picker and says the level of CO2 in our atmosphere is likely to go higher than it's been in 600,000 years.
It's already right here.
That blue line is temperature. Won't that go up too? Well, CO2 is widely understood to be a greenhouse gas, but it's only one of many, many factors that cause global warming. Water vapor is by far the most abundant greenhouse gas, and water vapor formation is not very well understood. I mean, if it were, AccuWeather would be a heck of a lot more accurate. Seriously, meteorologists can't even predict the local weather 10 days out. I don't think they can tell me how clouds are going to form 100 years from now. And if you look at Al Gore's actual data and move the temperature curve up to match the CO2 data, you'd see that while there is clearly a correlation between the temperature and the amount of CO2, the causation isn't so clear. Half the time, when both temperature and CO2 spiked, the temperature went up first, often thousands of years earlier. That is to say, the data shows correlation, but doesn't actually suggest that CO2 is what's causing the temperature to rise. Maybe there are other factors that affect both. And besides, during many of those spikes, global temperatures were actually higher than they've been in recent centuries. I guess Al Gore just cherry-picked his data. But again, this isn't to say that Al Gore is wrong to say there's too much industrial pollution. Pollution is harmful, and we should protect our planet. My point is, even Al Gore's mainstream film drew conclusions without really factoring in all the data. So, why didn't he just factor in all the data? Because he couldn't. There's too much data. No matter how fast computing power gets, climate models still rely on humans plugging in the right data sets and the right equations. And scientists still don't understand all the factors that affect the climate. That's why so many predictions have turned out to be wrong. For example, in 2000, The Independent in the UK published this article. It says, "Children just aren't going to know what snow is." Fast forward 19 years, those kids are all grown up, and that article has mysteriously been taken down. But now, a British newspaper is asking if 2019 will be the coldest winter on record. Yeah, that child probably knows what snow is. This is to say, a lot of climate models aren't very accurate. Scientists don't necessarily understand global warming enough to make accurate predictions. So, why don't we hear much from scientists who admit they don't understand? Because research that says humans are causing global warming gets a lot more funding than research that takes no stance or has a dissenting voice. Climate scientist Dr. Judith Curry from the Georgia Institute of Technology said in a 2015 U.S. Senate testimony that there is enormous pressure for climate scientists to conform to the so-called consensus. This pressure comes not only from politicians, but from federal funding agencies, universities, and professional societies. She gave an example, an email she received from a scientist employed at NASA. The employee said that they were told, "We should not try to publish papers contrary to the current global warming claims, because the NASA boss would then have a headache countering the undesirable publicity." Dr. Curry is pretty concerned about how politics is compromising climate research. It should be no surprise that money and politics can buy us science. And to be fair, it goes the other way too. The fossil fuel industry funds websites like this, with research showing how carbon dioxide is good for plant growth. So let's just have a picnic, take a totally unstaged photo, and forget about how we're releasing huge amounts of pollution into the air, okay? But obviously, most scientists who believe we don't know enough about global warming to assign a cause are not funded by the fossil fuel industry. But they also are much less likely to be funded by governments or universities. That makes sense. Who wants to fund research where the conclusion is, I don't know? All this being said, There are a lot of scientists who say they do understand climate change well enough to definitively state that humans are the main cause of global warming. But there are also a lot of scientists whose voices haven't been heard much who say there's not enough evidence or understanding to make that claim right now. This shouldn't be a surprise. It would be more surprising for 97% of people to agree on anything. But that doesn't mean we should scream at whoever disagrees with us. I mean, I get that's in fashion right now, but still. Global warming can be both real and not well understood. There are lots of ways we can all come together with a little less screaming. Burning fossil fuels releases CO2, but it also releases a lot of other chemicals into the air that are much worse. For example, in China, air pollution is killing 1 million people per year. So regardless of the impact of CO2 on global temperatures, we need to rein in toxic air pollution. There are lots of environmental and financial reasons to explore renewable energy and ways to make our world more energy efficient, even if that Wikipedia page also has a lock icon. For thousands of years, mankind has tried to live in harmony with the natural environment. Even if we don't fully understand what has been causing the Earth to get warmer, it's in the interest of future generations to cherish the planet, reduce pollution, and build structures that can endure a changing climate, no matter what unpredictable things happen. And before you go, this episode has been sponsored by MOVA Globes. You've seen a MOVA globe on my desk before, and now they have a beautiful new model of planet Earth as it looks from space. The technology is really amazing. When you pick it up, it keeps spinning. And when you put it back on its base, it corrects its motion and starts rotating. No cords, no batteries, it just works. And it's powered by ambient light, which is renewable energy. MOVA also has a bunch of other cool designs too. So click the link in the description below and pick your favorite version. And when you buy a MOVA globe, you'll also be supporting your favorite show about America that stars me, Chris Chappell. So click below to check it out now. Thanks for watching this episode of America Uncovered. I'm Chris Chappell. See you next time.